So, thank you very much for including me in today's fantastic session and giving me the pleasure to simply listen to the questions, listen to the answers from these great speakers. We've heard from Dr. Iseman giving us a fantastic historical perspective, Dr. Wallace telling us all about the lab and scaring us about the water, and then Dr. Van Ingen reminding us that this really is an environmental disease, and it differs not just by nation, but also by region within a nation. A nation as big as the U.S., there's so many different areas and so many different species that we're going to see. And then Gwen scared us a lot about talking about the water even more. So I'd like to invite everyone to please go ahead with your questions.
I heard quite a bit about where all the environments that this mycobacterium is found. And I'm just curious, there has to be some environmental parameters that the bacteria will simply die, like a minus 22 degrees or 200 degrees, and I can't believe it can survive in a stomach with a pH of 2. So do you know at which, how this bacteria and all of its subspecies can possibly live in all of these environments, or is that just part of the problem?
I'll comment a little bit about the temperature, because I think that's a very important issue. I know less about pH, and Leah Land has an abstract at the ATS, and they investigated an outbreak of MAC in a suburb of Philadelphia, and as part of the workup, they measured the temperatures of the water and cultured the water in the hot water heaters. And to my shock, I had no idea, except my house is like this. You can turn on the hot water and put your hand under it and it's warm. More than half of the hot water heaters, the temperature was 100 degrees or less. There are plumbing codes, nobody follows them. Most of the plumbers don't know what they are. Many of the hot water heaters don't have thermostats on them. They have low, medium, high, or they don't even have that on them. So I have no idea what the temperatures are. It's quite clear that temperatures of 100 or below are well within the growth range for most of these mycobacteria. Now, at one time, temperatures were much higher, and probably 30, 40 years ago, the temperatures were dropped. They were in the 120s or above. It's our perception that most of these organisms will not grow or survive at that temperature. Heating is one possibility that would potentially sterilize all the pipes, everything that's touched by the hot water. But honestly, I don't know much about the specific isolates that are recovered from patients' piped water system. That is, are these special aviums that survive at higher temperatures? The Zanopi love high temperatures, but is there a temperature above which they would not survive? We don't see M. abscessus, we don't recover M. abscessus that often, and I honestly don't know much about the thermotolerance. I think it's very important because it's one of the things that we could change, at least in the patients who are at risk, having bronchiectasis, whatnot. I don't think we have to go about and ask everybody to change their hot water system to do that. That's a very interesting approach and should be helpful for a number of organisms. I would think, I think Xenopi is considered to be primarily in household water. Yes, no? Kenzessii is in household water. And I'm surprised about the avium because there are some British studies where they were able to get avium out of the water. I think that's an area we need to spend some more money on looking at this. It's not that hard to determine taking isolates from the water and see what they grow at or see what they can survive or how long they can survive it. I think the pH is a good question. I think you'll have to ask the people who sell the purple pill. I bet there aren't five people in this room whose pH, gastric pH is two or less. Almost everybody is on proton pump inhibitors. And maybe that's part of the changing lifestyle that's contributed to having more MAC, more NTM.
Just regarding the pH, there's actually plenty of data out there for regular germs to say that there's now a very well documented, much higher incidence of what we call community acquired pneumonia, meaning pneumonia from other germs than mycobacteria in people that take proton pump inhibitors. So it's important to know that proton pump inhibitors, the purple pills, don't do anything to stop reflux. They just make the acidity of the stomach contents lower, and that is a good thing if you have heartburn or Barrett's esophagus or something. But if you don't have those, don't let any doctor give that medicine to you just because they say you have reflux.
I feel a little lonely here. I'm a pediatrician, and I'm a very scared pediatrician because I think that the time is not on our side. And I would like to bring up a new population beyond the skinny ladies and beyond the skinny men in the Netherlands that is a target of these organisms. So let me just give you a short history. I was 15 years at Harvard, and we had 450 patients with cystic fibrosis, and I was barely thinking about mycobacteria. In fact, the one important patient that I had, I shared with Dr. Iseman, were able to cure her from her mycobacterium by nebulized amikacin. And then in my sins, and comment to Dr. Huitt, I moved to Florida. I live now in Miami. I only have 100 patients with cystic fibrosis. 10% of them have mycobacteria. The majority mycobacterium abscessus. I had my first patient who got the first infection, so Pseudomonas was the thing that we always were thinking about and scared about. I have the first patient who had a 13-year-old who presented with MAC, severe lung disease, as the first presentation of any lung disease she ever had. And yesterday, I sent my first mycobacterium abscessus patient for transplantation. Never thought that this is going to come because she deteriorated in 7 years from no disease with cystic fibrosis to die, to almost dying, and it's a trend. Now, whether Florida is worse than other places, it may be, but the population that we have in Florida for pediatric patients with mycobacteria is probably cumulatively more than all the patients in this room. And I think that numbers are dramatically growing, and this is something that we need to think about. The scary thing about this is that I come to these meetings every year, and I come to other mycobacterial meetings every year, and I don't feel that I know what to tell my patients with cystic fibrosis. Beware of this, because this will get you mycobacteria. I'm dealing on the distal side of how to treat, who to treat, and all the things that are being discussed. I deal with this on a daily basis. I have not made any progress in telling them, watch out, because the water is going to kill you. Move to Denver. Move to Boston, do something, because you're going to be affected. So that's where I would like to get help.
I would comment that the CF Foundation has sponsored a meeting of experts, and for the first time this year, there will be some guidelines on diagnosis and treatment of NTM in the setting of CF. Now, much of the CF community, there's a wide variability in what clinics do. At one time when they were screened, more than half of the clinics do no routine NTM cultures at all. And much of the explosion of NTM has to do with starting to do routine sputum cultures. Now, I live in Texas. We have a lot of NTM. We do NTM cultures every time we do a sputum culture. And they all say, oh, that's too expensive. No, it's not. I mean, all that stuff gets paid for. I mean, whoever pays for the sputum cultures also pays, and you'll never learn what the prevalence is if you don't routinely do that. Now, it doesn't tell you what to do. So there are at least one, there is a set of guidelines which the CF community has never had. The second is to go back to Ken Olivier's. He's not up here. Ken Olivier's was one of the co-authors on a study in the prevalence of NTM in non-tuberculous mycobacteria. They sampled approximately 10%, and you can correct me if I'm wrong, of the adolescents with CF, and they had three cultures done over the space of a year for NTM. Not, he and I've kind of, it happened that a lot of the patients that were sampled, and maybe they were centers that volunteered, were in the Northeast. We only had a couple of sites in the Deep South. I think one was in Florida, one was in Miami, one was in New Orleans, and then one was in North Carolina. The two in, as I remember, Florida and North Carolina, 20% of their populations had NTM. It wouldn't surprise me that anywhere in the South that a 10 to 20% prevalence is not unusual. But again, following up on that, there have been no routine guidelines about doing cultures. Now, these guidelines recommend that patients have cultures done at least annually and more frequently if the patients are symptomatic. That's a huge jump for the CF community, who is kind of not being very aggressive despite the efforts of Ken Olivier and some others. So they're moving. They're not moving very quickly. But I think there's some physicians who are having the same experience you are. Not a very sick patient, and before you know it, they're going to transplant. So I bet all of us up here have had CF patients who've gone to transplant, who've had M. abscessus and deaths that were clearly related to M. abscessus. So it's a serious pathogen, and I congratulate the CF community, but I think a lot more can be done, especially by the CF Foundation, who can fund and push a lot more to be done.
So thanks for reminding us for that other population. There are many populations we need to think about. I think we have a question on the other side now.
I'm a clinician. We have a lot of M. abscessus in Hawaii. We don't see avium. This is in a pediatric long-term care facility. And there are a couple of problems, I think, with prevalence in general, like in, you know, children in general, those who don't have cystic fibrosis or may have some pulmonary problems. And from combing the literature, it doesn't appear that there is any consensus as to duration of treatment, whether you need to start with IV antibiotics for 2 months, as recommended by Dr. Huitt at the start, and what the definition of cure is. Do we actually cure and eradicate, or do we just suppress? And it, you know, when we reculture 2 years later, they have it again. Is it just suppression and not really eradication when we treat?
Well, I must say that's a very difficult set of questions, and you're absolutely right that there is no consensus on how and how long to treat. I mean, from the clinical standpoint, it's often clear which patient definitely needs treatment. But then if you go into the literature to find what is the optimal treatment, particularly for Mycobacterium abscessus, yeah, things do get murky. I think there's clear data now that shows that the start of treatment should be using IV drugs, because they are, sadly, the very few drugs that are active against this bug that has been called in literature an antibiotic nightmare for very good reasons, are IV drugs with no oral equivalent. So there is now, I think, consensus among most that patients should be started on two IV drugs and oral companion drugs and have IVs for at least a couple of months. In the Netherlands, we are very aggressive. We don't go for 2 months, we go for six. And try and have, but that's because we have a home-based care program. We have nurses go to patients' homes to change the IVs, and if that has to be done three times per day, it has to be done three times per day. That's the way our healthcare system works. That can be done. So we can be more aggressive in that sense, that we can have people on IVs at home for longer, as long as they are tolerated. And then the treatment duration and what to do in the phase when the IVs are no longer possible due to intolerance or practical issues, that is very hard. And I think that's where practices are really different between the different centers. And I know we do different things than the people at National Jewish do. We use different companion drugs and treatment duration. I mean, there are no clinical trials to support any treatment duration, and treatment duration also, by and large, is impacted by how treatment is tolerated and which drugs you use. I mean, if you use weak drugs we think are weak, you may want to use them for a longer period of time if they are tolerated as such. And so I think there are no clear-cut answers there yet, and it all depends on what is tolerable and what is practically feasible. And what do you think is achievable? I mean, whether a patient can be cured or whether treatment is suppressive in nature, I think that's the first thing that you really need to think of together. You know, so what can we possibly achieve? And that depends on the type of patient, type of disease. And that then feeds into which drugs you select. Do you use IVs? How long? And I think, well, Mike can add to that.
I really can't add to that. I was just going to volunteer my services beginning in Kauai and Maui and Lanai and the Big Island just to see what's going on. So we should talk afterwards.
Hi. I would like to hear about current knowledge and your theories on human-to-human transmission and nosocomial transmission.
There have been three outbreaks within the past 5 years in which person-to-person transmission was a likely possibility. Two of those involved CF centers, one in Seattle, one in the UK, and the third was a large surgical wound outbreak involving more than 2,000 patients in Brazil. All of these involved Mycobacterium maculans, and they also involved a very unique subset of maculans, and the organisms from these three outbreaks were very close together genetically using this thing we called whole genomic sequencing. There are random isolates that appear to look like these epidemic strains that are not associated with outbreaks. We don't know if they are different from those three or not. But basically, those three are the best evidence right now that we have, and we don't know if there's something special. Why did all three of those involve maculans, which isn't that common in this country, and they involved a subset of maculans that have some very unusual genetic composition, but for the most part, the risk remains really low. I haven't said that. The CF community actually they don't allow more than one CF patient to be at a, if we actually polled how many people had here at CF, some of you shouldn't be in the room. And I don't know whether that relates to NTM or that probably relates to all the potential pathogens that can be there. So the risk is very small. It's limited to just this one sort of group of organisms. And I think the jury is still out. I think the risk remains. If we thought the risk was great, we wouldn't be having this meeting.
I would like to add to that the microphone is further than I thought. Now, I would like to add to that, we have also seen, and we've published one example, families where we had two patients, generally they were partners, where you have one person with fibrocavitary disease, smear positive, excreting a lot of bacilli, and then the partner becomes ill within the next year, has the same disease with the same bug, and then by molecular typing it's exactly the same strain. And you know, we take out virtually all the plumbing in their house, we scrape it all, we try to find it, and we never ever find it. So we think perhaps it is possible, but I would like to add that it's really depends on a lot of things. You have to have someone excreting a lot of bacilli. And then the other person either inhaling them directly, but remember, these bacteria don't like our lungs. The lungs have to be somehow, either the lungs have to be different or the immune system has to be a little different. I mean, otherwise, we would all have NTM disease. So you have to have a recipient that is capable, sort of developing NTM disease. So the odds, I think, are in play here as well. You need a good source. You need a recipient that can actually develop NTM pulmonary disease. And you may need an intermediate, like a place where the bacteria just stick around. If you don't like cough up and the other one breathes in directly, like for tuberculosis, you need an intermediate surface perhaps. You know, your house just needs to be contaminated with the excreted NTM.
This leads to the second half of my question, which is, I recall taking care of someone who had a wound infection after a lap coli. And my question is, how should these scopes be cleaned, and how can you trust that the institution is doing it properly?
Well, that's a whole discussion in and of itself. There are standards by which every infection control department runs their infection control program at a hospital or a standalone center. Whether or not these protocols are followed is obviously a problem at times, because that's clearly how some of these outbreaks have occurred, because particular cleaning procedures were not adhered to. Or recently there was a case of an infections being spread in California, not mycobacteria, but they found a problem with the design of the scope and the cleaning mechanism that the facilities were told to do to clean that appropriately. So when new technology is developed, obviously infection control procedures have to be brought into play when you have these type of surgery centers or endoscopy centers or whatever, that these outbreaks have occurred. But generally speaking, some of them have been related to mycobacteria, and probably it's related to improper sterilization of equipment more often than not.
Another question waiting there.
Yes, I have a question about two topics. One of them concerns water, and the other concerns the culture that was mentioned. So I'll ask the culture question first. Can you talk more about that culture that you mentioned, where the results can be obtained in a day instead of 6 weeks? I don't know if that's on the market. If it is it only done in your lab? Is it done in other centers of excellence, or what? The water questions, is there an update on the NTMs in municipal water versus well water? And what are the dangers of swimming pools versus the benefits of the exercise you get from swimming?
The culture in one day generally presupposes that you've grown the organism. We don't have good systems available, at least in this country, for going to the sputum and screening for the presence of an organism except for tuberculosis. I mean, we'd like to have those, but we do not have those. None of the companies have ever gone after that. The answer is that if you have a certain mass of organisms that have grown, you can take those bugs, extract the DNA, treat it so that it's sterile, and then after you've extracted the DNA, run it through your sequencer, read the sequence, and that can be done in a day. Now, you get a culture, it has to be processed, then it has to be grown before you reach that day. But if you send a culture to a lab that does sequencing, they can do it in the same day. Why don't we do that all the time? Many of the cultures are contaminated. You don't see it, because it's on there. And so when we go directly to the sample and sequence it, we grow staph epi. The sequence says staph epi. Well, I know that's not what you sent it for. It just means that there's some other organisms there. So they're often subcultured. We look at the plates very carefully to make sure they're pure. There's nothing else there. Then we take that organism and do it. But the procedure of the sequencing can be done in a day. It's just getting there that generally takes the time. And most labs are going to that. It's not inexpensive. It does require, small hospital laboratories will never do that. It's gonna have to be a reference laboratory that does it, because we don't have any other tools besides that. But more and more larger laboratories are going to that because of the speed and accuracy with which the test can be done. There is another piece of equipment called, it won't mean anything to you, called MALDI. It's a mass spectroscopy which looks at protein patterns, which also is able to come up with an answer within a day, but it does require a grown organism to do that. It's sort of under investigation for the moment and may prove to be very useful as well, and also done very quickly. But again, we're dependent on being able to grow the organism generally in a pure culture before we can do the analysis.
If I can add to that briefly, we do, in our lab, we do PCR straight from clinical specimens. So if you submit a sputum on Monday, we screen it by PCR, and that takes 24 hours. And then on Tuesday, you know whether there's NTM DNA in the sputum sample. Now that sounds fantastic, but it's not. Because a lot of times, we do not know what it means. Because for many of the positive samples, cultures never turn positive. And sometimes that's because they are NTM that are very hard to grow in culture. But many a times, we just don't know. And you know, we're exposed to these NTM from the environment all day, every day. So if there's a tiny bit of NTM DNA in your sputum, that does not mean you have NTM pulmonary disease. If that would be the case, half of our country would have NTM pulmonary disease. We see a lot of positive PCRs have very little meaning. So that's why, even though we do the test, we're very, very critical of it. And in fact, we relate the results to classic smears. Because if the smear is positive and the PCR is positive, we're quite certain what we're dealing with. But if not, it's very, very shaky. So that's something to consider when thinking of these fast molecular tests. And that's why they haven't been commercially developed. No company would want to produce a test like this because it's so shaky. And we even see negative tests and then positive cultures. So that way around it also sometimes fails.
So we're going to defer the second part of that question, the really important one about well water and treated water, till an upcoming lecture that Dr. Thompson's going to give us later on.
So a few comments. So Richard, I don't know if we've had this discussion or not, but you should know that my oldest son is a fishing guide in Jackson Hole. So if your daughter wants to meet another fishing guide, let me know, okay? Just a couple of comments, one about the epidemiology and one about the treatment of MTM. These are still not reportable diseases in most places. Maybe it is in the Netherlands. I trust the epi more from the Netherlands than what's reported here, just because it's a smaller place and you might have a better handle on it. But I still think there's a lot we don't know. Much of this is numerator-driven. I believe the phenotypes you've described, but I still think there's a tremendous amount we don't know because we don't do the right surveillance for NTM like we do for M. tuberculosis. And we've said this for a long time. It really needs to get done somehow. The second issue is treatment, and I mention it here because this is the best advocacy we're ever going to get. We need to do randomized clinical trials. Gwen says 2 months of IV. Jakko says 6 months of IV. I don't know if I believe either one of you. We really don't know the optimal treatment. Again, this is anecdotal. This is the national Jewish way. There's the Texas way. There's the Netherlands way. We need multi-center clinical trials to get larger number of patients. I'm sure any of you can decide what those clinical trials are. We can come up with 6 questions in about 5 minutes. And these need to get funded so that we really can get better information to really know how to treat these diseases, especially M. chelonii and M. abscessus.
Okay, thank you very much for those comments. I think we're out of time, but I think those comments were really timely and act as a call to arms. Everyone in this room has picked up the arms already, but if we get more and more folks and family members interested, that's going to continue to improve the situation. Thank you very much for the fantastic questions, to the speakers for their great lectures this morning, and I look forward to the rest of the day.